Good morning, New Life Church. Thanks for joining us. And for those online, we thank you for joining us as well. As we stand to our feet and prepare our hearts for worship, I'd like to read out of the book of Psalms 28, verse 7. It says, "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy, and with my song I will praise him." So let's praise him this morning.
All I see.
that's a promise that we have from God through the assurance of the scriptures. That the battle belongs to him, that vengeance belongs to the Lord, and that we can put our trust, we can take our heavy yokes and put it upon him because he is faithful.
Oh. my place, laid aside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I
YouTube or Facebook. I just ask, Father, your blessing would flow upon them. You know our needs, Jesus. You know us better than we know ourselves. And so, Lord, we cast ourselves at your feet. We ask for your help. We ask for your grace. We ask for your strength. We ask you, Lord, to move and to work in our lives. And then, Lord, right here in Oak Ridge and in this auditorium this morning, speak afresh and anew to us. Speak new truth into our lives and help us, Jesus, to accomplish your will today, right here in Oak Ridge. Whatever it is you want to do in us, whatever it is that you want to do through us, Lord, we want your purpose in our life. We want your divine direction in our life. We want you to move us farther up the road. And so, Lord, I just ask you today to help us with the next step. I ask you today to guide us. I ask you, Lord, today to bring glory to your name. Now, Lord, you know those that are listening that carry the heaviest load today. And I ask you, Jesus, that you would lift that load, that you'd be near to your people, that they would sense your presence. You said it, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And so, Lord, wherever that heaviness is today, wherever the load is the greatest today, would you just lift the load? We invite, Lord, and ask that your Holy Spirit would speak to us, that your word would speak to us, that you would bring glory to your name. And Father, for what you'll do this morning in our lives, and what you'll do through your word, and what your Holy Spirit will speak to us, we'll give you the praise. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. And amen. You may be seated this morning. We welcome every visitor that's here this morning, trusting God to minister to you all morning long. Going to dismiss the children to children's church and make these few announcements this morning. Ladies, Bible study is about ready to get started again, and so I'll see the sign-up sheet in the foyer of the church, and they'll be ordering their books, and the title of their study is Calming My Anxious Heart, and so be sure to sign up so they can order the books. The Bible study actually starts October 15th, and so you want to do your best, lady, to be a part of the Bible study. Child Sponsorship Sunday is next Sunday. It's $10 for a chicken salad dinner, I think it is. And it's a very good dinner. It's just a boxed lunch. It's $10. And so, you know what, you might invite your family to church on Sunday morning. Tell them that you're gonna take them to dinner and take them out to the park here in Oak Ridge. There are wonderful parks. And so take them to Clark Park and take them to some of the parks in the area. Let me tell you what happens. It's phenomenal. It makes me wonder why we don't do it more often, but it's $10 for a boxed lunch. I think nearly all the money, I think somebody helps with the lunch. So if you sell 10 or 100 box lunches at $10, that's $1,000. For $1,000, we can sponsor 3 children through child sponsorship. And so that means that child will receive food, 1 lunch a day, they'll receive an education, and they'll receive whatever clothing they need, uniforms they need for schooling. And so for me, it's a no-brainer. If it's that easy, then we ought to do it. And so that's next Sunday. It's a box lunch. It's $10. And that all that money goes for child sponsorship. We do it every year. We've been sponsoring children every year. And so you'll want to be a part of it this next Sunday. And so sign up for a chicken salad lunch. It's a box lunch. And invite your friends. And I know some people have purchased them, taken to lunch the next day, put them in the refrigerator, to work, and sometimes they buy their co-worker work, and I'd like to do 100 boxes this year, so I think we can do 100 boxes. I don't think that's up a little bit more, but I think you're going to do it, and so we'll do it together in helping with child sponsorship. I want to thank you for a moment. Thank you for your ministry last week with the Heap family. What a wonderful job Steve and Brenda did last Sunday, and what a wonderful ministry. I wanted to tell you the offering last Sunday, you gave $1,652 to Heap Ministries. The Heaps were very pleased, and so it supports their ministry. I think he said that probably some of that money they'll be having like a coming up, Sunday, October 16th. And so put that on your calendar for a prime timer potluck. I think the next potluck, we're actually going to do a whole church-wide potluck. So put that on your calendar, and we'll have a great time together. Well, for a few moments this morning, I want to speak to you on the next step. I don't know if you do that in your life or not, but periodically in my life when I'm trying to figure out what to do, I'll say to Tina, well, what's the next step? What's the next step in our lives? Maybe nobody else does that. Maybe I'm just a little quirky or something. But you can phrase it any way that you want. Maybe it's what do we do now? But for me, it's the next step. How do I move my life forward? How do I do the will of God? What does God want in my life? How can I be a better person than what I am today? And so the question is the next step. And for those that are listening today in this auditorium, I suspect that those that are listening outside the auditorium, it's a reminder that in our lives that there are transformative moments in our lives. And I would tell you that the most transformative moment in your life is the moment of salvation. It's when you really surrender your life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. It's very simple. The Bible says if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And I remember that time, and I'm sure you remember that time when you finally said to God, Lord, I'm a sinner, and I need your help. Please forgive me of my sins. It sounds pretty simple, and it really is, but in that moment of trying, it was probably the most transformative moment in my life. When the burden of my sin was lifted, when I saw life differently, I was an eighth grader. I was pretty young, but I remember coming up. I did it at an altar prayer. It was a Sunday night service. I responded to the invitation. I asked Jesus to forgive me of my sins. But I remember leaving the place and thinking to myself, "Well, my parents aren't as bad as I thought they were." I remember going back to Edison School and thinking, "Well, this school is not as bad as I thought it was." I looked at my life and I thought, well, my life isn't as bad as I thought it was. You know what? It wasn't my brother or my sister, but it was me in need of the Lord. You know what I mean? Everything changed. It's a transformative moment in our lives. I remember the time, the second time that one of the most transformative moments in my life is when I really surrendered my life. When I really gave my life over to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, when I consecrated my life, when I said, Lord, you can take my life and use it for what you want. And in our doctrine, and I don't want you to get too caught up in the doctrine, but we call it sanctification. It's to be set apart for God's holy use, to be filled with the Spirit. That's what it means. And it just simply is this concept that my life doesn't belong to me, but my life belongs to God, and God can do whatever he wants to do with it. It's a transformative moment in my life. Now, I'm not suggesting you pray this way, but I remember praying this prayer as I think a freshman in high school, maybe sophomore in high school, and this is the way I prayed it. This is not doctrinal. You won't find this in the Bible necessarily, but I prayed this prayer. I was in earnest, and I was seeking God, and I wanted to give God every part of my life. And so I told the Lord, Lord, I'm just an old envelope. You can take this envelope and put any message that you want into this envelope. You can take this envelope and seal it. You can put the address on it. You can send me to Africa. You can send me to Brazil. You can send me to South America. You can send me, if I got to Kentucky, I had to struggle with that one for a little bit. But I said, Lord, you can even send me to Kentucky. Now, there's a backstory to that. That's a true story. But I struggled with that concept of Eastern Kentucky. A lot of homesickness there for me. So you can send me anywhere you want me to go, and you can seal me with your approval, and then put your stamp on me. I'm yours. And it was a transformable moment when in my life, especially in my young life, when I realized that I didn't have to be anything other than the servant of the living God. That God could take my life and use it for his glory. We have hymns, O of salvation. The transformative moments in our life is when we really consecrate our lives to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. But in this auditorium, and for maybe a few weeks here, I would like to address this concept of the next step in our lives. Because I suspect that all of you are at a next step. You're kind of in between. You're trying to kind of figure it out. You're trying to maneuver. I had a pastor friend said, you know, Keith, sometimes it's better to maneuver through life. And I agree with that concept. Instead of beating life, instead of struggling with life, just seek God and maneuver through life, trying to find the next step. For a few moments this morning, I want to go to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22 to 24, and I'm going to read it out of the NIV. It says, you've learned the truth that is in Jesus, so in regard to your former way of life, put off your old self and be made new in the attitude of your mind, and put on the new self created to be like God, truly good and holy. Can I read it again? It's talking about the next step. Now there's a little song that we sang. Matter of fact, I knew that the Lord had helped me and helped my attitude when I got saved. I learned this little song, for the best thing in my life I ever did do, for the best thing in my life I ever did do, for the best thing in my life I ever did do was take off the old robe, put on the new. The old robe was dirty, all tattered and torn. Aren't you glad I'm not singing it? The new robe was spotless and had never been worn. Oh, the best thing in my life I ever did do was take off the old robe and put on the new. That's what the scripture is talking about. He says, you've learned the truth that is in Jesus, so in regard to your former way of life, put off your old self and be made new in the attitudes of your mind. And put on your new self, created to be like God, truly good and holy. Maybe I want to say it another way. In this auditorium, and those that are listening, we have to be reminded that we are the sum total of all of our past and our past experiences. And that's why we're so different. We come together in this auditorium, and I grew up in a home where my dad was a factory worker in northern Indiana. You come with a different experience. Some come from homes that were very disciplined, and some come from homes that were overly disciplined. Some come from homes that were never disciplined. We all come together and we're different. You and I are the product of our past, but we're not prisoners of our past. We're not defined by our past. We're not prisoners of the things that have happened in our life. We're not prisoners of those moments in our lives that we would like to erase. We're not prisoners of the poor choices we've made in our lives. We're not prisoners of the way that we were reared or the homes that we came from or come from. We're the product of our past, but we're not prisoners of our past. Are you with me? That ultimately we whether in put into our lives are all these things, all these experiences in our life that make us who we are. And so you have likes and dislikes that are different from mine because it was all put into your life. That's why Jesus, when he said, man looketh on the outward appearance, but God looketh on the heart. God was saying in reality that you and I, we don't know each other, really. We talk to each other before, we go to eat with each other, we commune with each other, but in reality, I don't know your life experiences. There are some things in your life you've never shared, and you'll probably never share in your life. You're the sum total of all those And this person is a wonderful employee. He's top notch. He's a hard worker. He's disciplined. And I said, I would ask. He was going to make a little change in his schedule. And I said it this way. Because the Bible says, if ye have not, because ye ask not. And so you've been you have a long track record. You have a long work history at the company that you serve. And so I think I would ask your employer if you could make this little adjustment in your schedule. And I thought to myself, if the employer doesn't make the adjustment, then that tells me something about the employer, because I know the employee and I know his work ethic. And she would be ill-advised not to make some changes in his schedule. It's true in our relationship with Jesus Christ that we start asking God to do something new in our lives. He said, I'm making everything new, Revelation chapter 21, verse 5. I'm making everything new. God, the Bible says in Psalm chapter 51, out of the Message, God, make a fresh start in me. This is David. Shake a Genesis week in the chaos of my life. David has sinned with Bathsheba and sent Uriah off to war. And now he's caught and he's praying and he's crying out to God. And he's saying to God, God, change my life. Make me new. Change my now and change my future. Make me new. We know the story of David, that God restores him. And the Bible says that David is a man after God's own heart. God does something powerful in David's life. Listen to what he says in Isaiah chapter 43. The Lord says, forget the former things and do not dwell in the past. It says, look at the new things I am going to do. They are already starting to happen. Can you see what I've begun to do? Isaiah chapter 43, verse 18 and 19. Somewhere in our lives, we begin to ask God, the Holy Spirit, to change us. That we're honest with ourselves and we say, I want to make a change. I want to be a new person. I want to go a different trajectory. And I want God to help me. You remember the psalmist David said, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit in me. And he's saying to the Lord, Lord, help me, change me. Make me, mold me into something new. We start asking God to renew us. We start asking God to help us to change. We start asking God, the Holy Spirit, to help us to mature in areas of our lives where we've been very immature in our lives. Start asking God to do something new. Number two, we pinpoint specifically what I want to change in my life. What I want to change, where the things I want to reset in my life. You know, the truth of the matter is you can't change generality. Does that make sense? If you're asking something in general, if you say, okay, Lord, change my life, that's kind of meaningless. And it's just a general concept, to change my life. But when we talk to the Lord, we pinpoint the areas of our life that we specifically want God to work on in our life. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5, look closely at yourselves, test yourself to see if you are really living in the faith. Oh Lord, these are the areas of my life that I want you to change. These are the areas in my life I need your help, and these are the areas in my life that I want you to reveal yourself and your power and your glory in my life. These are the areas in my life that I need the help the most. These are the areas of my life that I need to change the most. These are the areas of my life that I need divine intervention. And again, it's asking God for the next step. It's asking God to mature us. It's asking God to help us to leave our childish ways and do the will of God, to be the men and women of God that God wants us to be. And so we go through our lives and we begin to ask specifically things in our life. Look closely at yourself. Test yourself to see if you're really living in the faith. Maybe it's my connection with God that needs to change. begin to ask the Lord to help me to find scripture and spend time with God on a regular basis. It's a sense of asking God, and when we begin to ask the Lord begins to speak to us and changes us. Perhaps it's my career or job that I'm seeking the Lord for. Look closely at yourselves. Test yourselves to see if you're really living in the faith, Lord. I'm asking you to help me with my job. I was speaking with somebody yesterday, and again, I was reminded that God is as much a part of our career as he is our worship life, or he is the rest of our life. And we begin to ask the Lord, Lord, what's the next step in my life? What's the next step in my career? Where is it that you want me to go? And what is it that you want me to do? Maybe the next step is my parenting skills. Oh God, you know I need a touch of God. You know I want to be a better mother. I want to be a better father. I want to be a better grandparent. Lord, whatever it is that you're doing in my life, would you reveal yourself and would you help me? Would you help me to focus on this area of my life? Look closely at yourself. Test yourselves. Maybe it's my health that I need to change. Maybe it's my thought life, that my thought life is negative, that my thought life isn't pure, that my thought life isn't what God wants it to be. Help me with my thought life. Maybe my thought life is ruminating, that I take one failure in my life and I just ruminate on it. I just think about it. I rehash it. Person. Maybe it's bitterness that pervades my mind that I can't get over. I need to ask God. I can't move my life forward. I can't mature. I can't move to the next step until the Lord helps me with my thought life, until he delivers me from this prison of my mind. Maybe it's my schedule. Lord, help me with my schedule to be sure that there's a place for God and there's a place for rest. There's a place to focus on eternity. Maybe it's my priorities that are wacky, and I'm asking the God to help me in the next step of my life to get my priorities in order that I might accomplish his will in my life. Maybe it's my marriage. And I'm saying, Lord, I need your help to mature in my marriage. That unless you help me, unless you guide me, then my marriage won't be what God intended for it to be. And so we look at the next step and we begin to ask ourselves, oh God, help me with my marriage. Maybe it's my confidence that I struggle with insecurity and confidence. And I'm asking God, the Holy Spirit, to look closely at myself and test myself and see and help me to know what it is that keeps me from insecure. I believe the gospel of Jesus Christ moves our lives forward. I believe the gospel of Jesus Christ matures us. I believe the gospel of Jesus Christ takes us beyond our past failures and beyond our past experiences and frees us to be what God wants us to be. And so in our prayer life, we say, oh God, this insecurity in my life is not correct. It's overwhelming. Help me, Lord, to trust you, to believe you. I don't know about you, but sometimes it's when I get in those places in my life that I don't know what to do, I just sing. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him. How I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus. Oh, for grace to trust you more. When you're insecure, it makes a difference. You can trust the Lord. You can believe the Lord. And he'll help you do things you didn't believe and you didn't dream was possible in your life. everybody else's problem in the relationship. It just might be me. And before I ever do anything in my life, before I ever mature in my life, before I ever get to the next step, I'll have to ask the Lord to help me in my relationships. Maybe I'm caustic. Maybe my tongue engages before my mind does. Maybe there's something in my life that has followed me my entire life, and I'm asking God to pinpoint specifically what I need to change in my life. Perhaps it's my routine or my finances, that my finances have been a hindrance in my life, that I've not been able to tell myself no, that I've not been able to be disciplined. And so it's always my finances. And the truth of the matter is that I struggle in my life because I can't get my finances in order. And for me to ever move to the next step, then this is an area of my life where I need to be disciplined. This is an area of my life that I need to be strengthened. This is an area of my life that God needs to help me. Do you know that there's more said about money in the Bible than there is about hell? The Bible speaks specifically over and over again about our finances, and the Lord wants to help us with our finances. Maybe it's my energy level, or my habits, or my dreams. Whatever it is in your life, we need the help of God. We need to pinpoint specifically what I want changed in my life. Quit living in the generalities of life and ask God, the Holy Spirit, that help in the area that's most needed. Listen to what he says in Romans chapter 12, verse 3. Do you think you're better than you really are? Decide what you really are by the amount of faith God has given you. He just basically saying, take an assessment of your life. Be honest with yourself. Ask God to help you. And ask the Holy Spirit to lead you. I was in nursing school. And it was the first class. Matter of fact, my pen had a little star on it. First class, Penn State. And I was worried. They were worried. They wanted at least a 90% pass rate. And there was 50 students in that classroom. And so this is good, bad, ugly. You may think ill of me. That's fine. Well, it's not really fine. I hope you won't think this the wrong way. But I looked over the class. I kind of knew what people were doing in the class. And this is the way I read it. I knew that I wasn't, if they needed a 10% at least pass rate, then that would be 10% of 50 is 5, right? And so I looked over the class and tried to figure out where I was. Now, there were some students in that class that were just absolutely brilliant. And I thought, I know I'm not in that top 5%, 10% of the class, so that kind of knocked me out. And I looked over the class, and, you know, I kind of watched and listened to people groan as they got their grades back. And, you know, it wasn't long until I found out that I was, I didn't think I was in the bottom 10% either. That I was somewhere at least in the middle. It gave me great comfort to think that when it came to the NCLEX exam, that if they were going to do a 90%, that somewhere I was somewhere in there, and I'd be all right. That's an honest assessment of yourself. Maturity comes in our lives when we begin to ask God to help us to see ourselves as God sees us. To help us to see ourselves through honest eyes. Do not think you are better than you really are. Decide what you really are by the amount of faith God has given you. Let's hasten on. Number three, find some people to support you in your next step. Listen to what he said in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 12. A person standing alone can be attacked and defeated, but two can stand back to back and conquer. And three are even better, for a triple braided cord is not easily broken. There's something powerful about living in community. Listen to what he says in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 10. If one person fails, another can reach out and help. But people who are alone when they fail are in real trouble. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 10. Community is God's antidote to discouragement, defeat, and failure. There's something about living in community when we share with each other our burdens, when we share say and thank the church that over these many years that I've pastored, that the church has helped me. The church has opened my mind. The church has opened my thinking to things that I never would have thought of. I grew up in a little town in Hammond, Indiana, in the suburbs of Chicago. My dad was a factory worker and went to the South Steel every day. I remember as a child going to the South Steel, they had a big old whistle, and when the whistle blew at 3 o'clock, we were listening to something Sam, I don't know. It was Focus on the Family or something. Sailor Sam it was. We were listening to Sailor Sam, and that whistle would blow, and my dad would come out of the factory and get in the car, and we would go home. We lived that way my whole childhood life. But it's been the church that has opened my thinking. It's been the church that's given me a broader sense of life. It's been the church that has given me a different world vision of the world. It's the church that has opened my thinking, and together, in community, we build each other, we lift each other, we encourage each other, we open thinking in each other, we do the will of God. Listen to what the Bible says in Romans chapter 12, verse 5, since we are all one body in Christ, we belong to each other, and each of us needs all the others. Finally, number 4, we begin to eliminate anything unhealthy. Or unhealthy. You'll never move to the next step in your life until you begin to ask God to remove the things in your life that are unhelpful. Listen to what he says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. We should remove anything from our life that would get in the way and the sin that is so easily holds us back. The King James says to be setting. The NIV says the reoccurring sin in our lives. We give you another version. We must get rid of everything that slows down your progress, especially the sin that just won't let go. We must be determined to run the race that is ahead of us, and we must keep our eyes on Jesus. On Jesus. Who eliminate anything unhelpful. Unhelpful. Sometimes it's just our attitude. There are some that live with this concept that everybody's against me. You know what I found in my life? That most people are for me. But more importantly, the Lord is for me. Amen. We even sang it a little earlier. If God be for us, who can be against us? That attitude that the world is out to get me probably needs to be cleansed. And there needs to be a sense of God's presence. That there's a host of people that want me to succeed. I'm grateful for every school teacher that invested in my life. I'm grateful for every college professor that fed into my life. I'm grateful for every church board member that fed into my life. Over the years, I've had people over and over again. And by and large, I found that people are for me. And that when I begin to think that they don't know me or understand me or they don't love me, I'm wrong. I'm wrong. Because they're just asking. Because they care. And it's my attitude. that over and over again you find yourself involved in and you need the help of God with the sin that does so easily beset us. The Bible is very clear, and human nature is the same, that you and I don't struggle over 10 sins or 20 sins. It's one or two sins that get us in trouble, and they are reoccurring. And the Bible says that we're to get rid of the besetting of sin in our life. We should remove anything from our lives that would get in the way, and the sin that so easily holds us back. For some, it's the sin of pride. The sin of pride that needs to be eliminated, that we need to crucify ourselves, that we need to seek God and call on God and believe God. For some, it's envy, because in your life you'll never be happy. You're always looking at somebody that has more, that somebody has better and bigger than you do. And it's envy in your life that you struggle with, and it's destroying your life. It's destroying your happiness. It's destroying your goals. And if you ever move to the next step, you'll have to ask God, the Holy Spirit, to cleanse you of this unbelievable envy and jealousy and pride in your life. Eliminate anything unhelpful, unhealthy. Before we move on to the next step, we're going to have to ask God to cleanse us. For some, it's anger. That hot, flashy anger that gets us in trouble. It makes us say things we wish we hadn't said. Until we ask God to eliminate it, to cleanse us. Until we ask God, the Holy Spirit, to temper our temper. It'll always be a weight that holds us down. If you want to mature, if you want to be what God wants you to be, if you want to take the next step, if you want the fullness of His Spirit, if you want God to move your life forward, then start asking God to do something new. Start asking God to change some things in your life. Ask others to support you in the next step of your life. And ask God, the Holy Spirit, to eliminate, to cleanse the things in your life that hold you back. It's the next step in life. And for each of us in this auditorium, and for those that are listening, each of us are struggling to seek God, the Holy Spirit, to move us forward. Would you stand? Daisy, could we just sing maybe a verse or two of that song? Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. It's an old hymn that just says, Lord, help me in the next step. Help me to accomplish Your will. Let's pray. Father, thank You for the privilege of coming to Jesus. Thank You, Lord, that You know all about us and that You love us. Thank You, You said, if every deed You have called You by name, You are mine. And now, Lord, Holy Spirit of God, guide us today, we pray. Father, for the way that You'll minister to us, for the way that You'll help us, we'll give You the praise, for it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Take my life.
Sing it if you know it.
Take my throne, rest and my day.
invite to make that move this morning. We welcome you. We'd love to close in prayer with you. Whoever God is speaking to this morning, we welcome you to come and pray as we sing another verse of the song. Please.
So take my word.
Take my word and make it mine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own. It shall be thy royal throne.
For the way that you'll bring glory to your name, we'll give you the praise, for it's in the